It is my honor to be able to introduce the author of the evening, Stephen Levingston. He is the nonfiction editor of the Washington Post, and he has also worked for the Wall Street Journal, the International Herald Tribune, the Associated Press, and the China Daily. His new book, Barack and Joe, The Making of an Extraordinary Partnership, chronicles a political bromance for the ages, the friendship between Barack Obama and Joe Biden. This book explores how two men with vastly different personalities shed their initial wariness of each other to acquire a mutual respect that eventually blossomed into a productive working relationship. Levingston tracks the impact and journey of the Obama-Biden dynamic through key events of Obama's two terms. The relationship was tested and refined through 8 years of facing economic, social, military, and personal crises, yet the two men remained close. Stephen Levingston's book, Barack and Joe, provides the reader with a comprehensive and heartwarming portrait of deep friendship and genuine affection in the last presidency. Everyone, please join me in welcoming Stephen Levingston.
Well, thank you, Sly. That's very nice. Thank you all for being here. I appreciate it, especially on another historic night where the Nationals are out there pushing again, another historic game. What's the score, Scott?
1-0.
Okay. So we're okay. But it's great to be back here at Politics and Prose. What this place does for this city is immeasurable. It nourishes the mind and soul of a town that often appears to have lost both. We're lucky to have Politics and Prose and the many voices it supports on its shelves at these book events. Well, thank you, Politics and Prose, for that and for having me here. So if you're feeling a little tired of the news, the scandals, the corruption, the investigations, the endless insanity that engulfs us, I have a remedy. It's only temporary. It will last only for the next 25 or 30 minutes, but it's a remedy. It's called escape. Today, we have a president and vice president who don't laugh or even smile. They rarely are seen together. They seem to find no joy in their jobs or in each other. But if you turn back the clock just a few years, things look different. Things look like this. A president and vice president laughing, taking in a basketball game, having lunch together, and dessert. Horsing around, maybe a little golf. And yes, doing their jobs. And always, always just seeming to like each other. Kind of like Buzz and Woody. I'm sticking with this Buzz and Woody friendship for a minute. I went a little over the top and put together this little mashup.
You've got a friend in me. You've got a friend in me. When the road looks rough ahead and you're miles and miles from your nice warm bed, you just remember what your old boy, you got a friend in me.
Well, the point is, they made it all seem so natural, so normal, their companionship and their good cheer. But it wasn't normal. Presidents and vice presidents don't behave this way. The Obama-Biden friendship was something we had never seen before in America. A president and vice president who found strength in each other, a willing ear, wise counsel, a friendly shoulder, brothers who had each other's back. Here were two guys leading the world who enjoyed the job and enjoyed each other's company. What I'd like to do now is explore how this relationship came about, how it began as a political partnership, how it navigated the rough patches, and how it evolved into a true friendship. From the very beginning of our republic, the president and vice president were thrown together not for friendship. It was clear that the office of the vice president existed for one reason and one reason only. Just 5 days after our first president, George Washington, was sworn in, our first vice president, John Adams, summed up his role. "I am vice president," he said, In this, I am nothing, but I may be everything. It's no wonder, then, that presidents weren't terribly thrilled to be around their vice presidents. The vice president symbolized something the president would prefer not to think about. Friends of President Kennedy noticed he was a little on edge whenever he was around his vice president, Lyndon Johnson. Maybe it was Johnson's personality, or maybe it was the unspoken. Whatever it was, Johnson was keenly aware of it. As he put it in his colorful language, "Every time I came into John Kennedy's presence, I felt like a goddamn raven hovering over his shoulder." Throughout history, vice presidents were allotted minor tasks. They were kept busy and out of the way, often on diplomatic or ceremonial missions. The rambunctious Theodore Roosevelt asserted that the chance for a vice president, in his words, to do much of anything is infinitesimal. So the odds of these guys, of a strong, constructive partnership, were against Barack and Joe. They could have gone the way of all the others, but they didn't. Their friendship, however, was not predestined. There was no gravitational pull one man toward the other, no instantaneous clicking of like personalities. Here we had a cerebral African-American who sweated over the precision of his words, and an older, chummy white guy who liked to spray words in all directions. The early signs were not promising. Barack and Joe first encountered each other in the Senate in 2005. Barack was a freshman, a newcomer, an outsider looking in. But he had something else, the glow of celebrity. Barack had burst upon the political world with his exhilarating keynote address at the Democratic National Convention in 2004. We all remember it.
There is not a liberal America and a conservative America. There is the United States of America. There is not a black America and a white America and Latino America and Asian America. There's the United States of America.
He looks awfully young. After that, Barack was the young, cool future of the Democratic Party. In the Senate, he chafed against the slow pace of the institution and mocked the grandstanding of the old-timers. Joe, by contrast, was a man of the Senate, a veteran of 32 years. He honored the chamber's long traditions and its way of operating. He told people that Obama should fall in line and respect the Senate hierarchy. But Joe was, in many ways, a prime example of an old-time Senate windbag. When Biden got the floor, Obama sat and listened, and listened, and listened. After listening to Biden rattle on during a committee hearing, Obama jotted a note to an aide sitting behind him. It contained three words: "Shoot me now." During his freshman term in the Senate, Obama asserted again and again that the White House wasn't his immediate goal. But soon enough, look at that crowd, he was in the race for the 2008 nomination. He and Joe were now competitors. The presidential battlefield was not fertile ground for friendship. As Obama gained momentum, attracting giant crowds, Biden stumbled, and by January, he was out. But in March, Obama confronted a dire threat to his surging candidacy in the form of his longtime pastor, the Reverend Jeremiah Wright. An investigative reporter for ABC News had found tapes of Reverend Wright preaching to his congregation on the issue of race in America. To white America, his language was inflammatory, and his examples were extreme. Wright had revealed in dramatic form the nation's sharp racial divide. The media splashed his incendiary sermons across the country. His words lit up the internet, the evening news broadcasts, and were printed in newspapers coast to coast. As a promising African-American candidate for president, Barack had no choice. He had to face the storm head on. With his campaign on the line, he took to the stage in Philadelphia to speak about the sensitive subject of race in America. In his speech titled "A More Perfect Union," Obama denounced Wright's radicalism, but also gave America a measured lecture on racial history, the legacy of slavery, Jim Crow, and the persistence of inequality. The speech was brilliant, even magical, for it saved Obama's campaign. In the words of the candidate's chief strategist, David Axelrod, "What looked to be a moment of peril for Obama turned into a moment of triumph. The speech had a profound impact on one man in particular, Joe Biden. And it opened Biden's eyes to the wisdom and grace of Barack Obama. Biden told an advisor, "That may have been the best speech I've ever heard a political leader give." As the advisor told me, that speech was a click moment for Biden. The elder senator saw the freshman in a new light. Biden had a newfound respect and admiration for Obama. And simultaneously, Obama had begun to see the strengths of Joe Biden. Barack had been impressed with Joe's performances in the Democratic debates before he left the campaign trail. Having watched Joe blather in Senate hearings, Obama was skeptical of how Joe would perform on the debate stage. But he saw something he hadn't expected, a disciplined Biden. Axelrod also saw it, telling me Biden was consistently one of the better debaters. On stage, Joe also demonstrated his expertise in foreign policy, and Obama appreciated Joe's insight in a field where he still had a lot to learn. Soon, Biden was on the shortlist of potential vice presidential nominees, and he had big ideas on the role of the vice president. He wanted to be a vice president unlike any other. He wanted a relationship that was deep and personal. Joe wanted to be Obama's chief counselor. He wanted to be included in every important meeting. He wanted his views considered on every crucial decision on both foreign and domestic policy. He wanted to be the last guy in the room, whispering in Obama's ear. Joe hadn't come up with all of this entirely on his own, however. He relied on a similar approach that Walter Mondale had laid out in a memo as vice president to Jimmy Carter. A key facet of the Mondale vision was this. He believed it was absolutely necessary to have someone very high ranking who wasn't afraid to speak tough truths to the president. Mondale filled that role for Carter, and Biden wanted to do the same for Obama. And to his credit, Barack fully agreed. Soon after he announced his running mate, Obama went on 60 Minutes to explain why he chose Joe.
If I'm in the room making the kinds of tough decisions that the next president's going to have to make, both on domestic policy and on international policy, then I want the counsel and advice of somebody who's not going to agree with me 100% of the time. In fact, somebody who's independent enough that can push back and give me different perspectives and make sure that I'm catching any blind spots that I have. And Joe Biden doesn't bite his tongue.
Here, Obama signaled his growing respect for Joe and his desire to work closely with him. Obama wanted his White House to be a tight-knit team, starting at the top with the president and vice president. But once Biden was on the ticket, the partnership had trouble finding its footing. Of course, there were the Biden gaffes. They were mostly insignificant and arose out of Joe's enthusiasm, humility, or generosity. There was, for instance, Biden's quip that Hillary Clinton perhaps would have been a better pick for vice president. It was a humble statement, but on the campaign trail, it became an issue for Obama. It threw into question what was traditionally a candidate's most important pre-presidential decision, his selection of a running mate. But in the end, none of Joe's slip-ups mattered. The Obama ticket prevailed. But then again, after the election, the gaffes kept coming, and the media kept pouncing. Now, here's a snippet from a video with some satirical music created by one news organization.
Barack Obama. But the Taoiseach knows a lot about it. His mom lived in Long Island for 10 years or so, God rest her soul, and although she's, wait, your mom's still alive as your dad passed. God bless her soul. I gotta get this straight. Now is the time to heed the timeless advice from Teddy Roosevelt. Speak softly and carry a big stick. End of quote. I promise you, the president has a big stick. I promise you.
The media reported Joe's verbal miscues as powerful blows to the administration and to the working relationship of Barack and Joe. And of course, there was this one. Just as the Obama re-election campaign was kicking off in 2012, Joe appeared on Meet the Press and got a question he wasn't expecting. Host David Gregory wanted to know, where did Biden stand on the still unresolved question of same-sex marriage?
What this is all about is a simple proposition. Who do you love? And that's what people are finding out is what all marriages at their root are about. Whether they're marriages of lesbians or gay men or heterosexuals.
Is that what you believe now?
That's what I believe.
And you're comfortable with same-sex marriage now?
I am Vice President of the United States of America. The president sets the policy. I am absolutely comfortable with the fact that men marrying men, women marrying women, and heterosexual men and women marrying men are entitled to the same exact rights, all the civil liberties. And quite frankly, I don't see much of a distinction beyond that.
Joe answered honestly and ignited an uproar because President Obama had never said he supported same-sex marriage. Privately, Barack agreed with Joe, but his aides had told Obama to keep quiet. The politics of the issue, they believed, could damage his presidency and his chances of re-election. But the controversy only escalated, and within days, Obama knew he had to act. Robin Roberts of ABC's Good Morning America got a call from the White House. The president had something he wanted to say.
At a certain point, I've just concluded that, for me personally, it is important for me to go ahead and affirm that I think same-sex couples should be able to get married.
A Gallup poll taken later that week found that 50% of Americans supported legalizing same-sex marriage. The political risk that so frightened Obama's aides apparently was unfounded. Joe's misstep did nothing to harm the administration or Obama's chances of re-election. In fact, Joe gave the president the chance for leadership on an issue that they both held close to their heart, equal rights for all Americans. Thanks to Joe, Obama now owned the issue of same-sex marriage, and the accolades belonged to the president. The New York Times said, it has always taken strong national leadership to expand equal rights in this country, and it has long been obvious that marriage rights are no exception. President Obama offered some of that leadership. In his memoir, Joe described his Meet the Press remarks as a Biden gaffe, but he said it didn't cause any real disturbance between him and Barack. As Joe recalled, Barack didn't take me to task for speaking my mind about an issue I cared deeply about. After the interview, President Obama and Robin Roberts took a stroll along the White House grounds. Roberts asked about Biden. Did he jump the gun a little here? She wondered. Obama didn't seem terribly concerned. He told Roberts, Joe probably got out a little bit over his skis, but out of a generosity of spirit. So this Biden gaffe, like so many of his others, was little more than Joe expressing himself with passion. His gaffes often revealed his authenticity and, as Obama said, his generosity of spirit. Of course, the gaffes sometimes complicated the relationship, but in the big picture, they were not a lasting detriment. They had little negative impact on the administration. No sensitive national security secrets were revealed. No diplomatic relationships were harmed. No policies were impaired. Joe's contribution as vice president far outweighed his stumbles. To name a few, he took a leading role in the stimulus program during the financial crisis. He lined up the necessary congressional votes for Obama's health care reform legislation. And in private meetings filled with White House advisors, he provoked vigorous debate on a variety of delicate policy issues. Obama accepted that Biden might go off script now and then, and yet still be an effective partner. According to White House advisor Liz Allen, the gaffes simply weren't that important. She told me that Obama believed in playing the long game. He looked past the ups and downs of the moment. And, as she told me, it was the same for the relationship. It was this kind of attitude that paved the way for a strong, working relationship and ultimately a profound friendship. And nowhere was the shared affection between Barack and Joe more apparent than in the traumatic days of Beau Biden's illness and death. Beau had followed his father into public service, becoming a much-loved two-term attorney general in Delaware. His political future looked bright. There was even talk of a run for the presidency someday. He and his father had sharply different styles. Beau was calm and disciplined and cautious when speaking publicly. A Delaware Supreme Court justice who knew both father and son explained that with Beau, there was less theater. Beau's first hint of trouble came in 2010 when he woke up one morning at age 41, paralyzed on one side of his body and unable to speak. Hearing the news, Joe raced off to be with his son at the hospital. Beau's symptoms, which pointed to a stroke, disappeared after a few hours to the relief of everyone. But President Obama clearly was worried for Beau and Joe and the Biden family. David Axelrod described for me what he saw when Joe returned to the White House. I was sitting in my office, which was right next to the Oval Office, and I saw the president kind of sprint down the hall because he had heard Biden was back. I ran into the hall to see where he was running. Axelrod told me he saw the president down at the end of the hall near the vice president's office, and they were embracing. Axelrod told me he saw the president. Beau seemed fine after his stroke scare, but uncertainty hovered over the family and their close friends, including the president. A defining virtue of President Obama was his rigorous preparation for every meeting. He read his brief and always arrived ready to engage on any topic. At one meeting, soon after Beau's health emergency, the president seemed distracted. Axelrod described for me what he saw that morning. The president simply wasn't attending, he said. He was looking out the window. People were talking, but Obama's mind was elsewhere. Finally, the president said, "I don't know how Joe is going to go on if something happens to Beau." And a few years later, the worst came. Beau was diagnosed with brain cancer, and he and his family began a slow, painful journey. Despite the latest experimental treatments, Beau was losing the battle. And by April 2014, he took a distressing turn. His speech began to falter, and he worried that his mental acuity might go. Joe was concerned that Beau might have to step down as attorney general, putting his family at financial risk because he was the sole breadwinner. During one of his weekly private lunches with Barack, Joe revealed the circumstances. He told the president that he was prepared to take out a second mortgage on his house to support Beau and his family. A wave of emotion crossed Barack's face, and he got up and walked around the mahogany table and laid his hands on Joe's shoulders. "Don't do that," Barack said with surprising force. "I'll give you the money. I have it." Barack was standing behind Joe with his hands still on Joe's shoulders. "You can pay me back, whenever." It was painful for Barack to see Joe as a father go through so much anguish, all the medical treatments, and now the financial concerns. Barack was searching for ways to help. As Biden's longtime friend and advisor, Ted Kaufman, told me, you could just see how hurt Obama was. Joe never availed himself of Barack's generosity, but the offer was the important thing. Obama's education secretary, Arne Duncan, told me that the offer's true significance lay in its symbolism. It wasn't about the money, Duncan told me. It was about the closeness and the shared pain and anguish, the concern and compassion, and I'll say it, the love. This love was deep, deeply moving, and deeply meaningful to the vice president at a time of obviously unimaginable heartache. Beau died 2015, and at his funeral, President Obama delivered the main eulogy. His words captured Beau's character and the bond that Beau and his father shared. At times, Barack seemed to fight off tears. He'd stop and take a breath. He kept a tissue in his pocket, and now and then he dabbed it at his lips or touched it to his nose. I'm going to play about a minute and a half of Obama's eulogy. This particular part is revealing on many levels. It defines the special qualities of Beau and the Bidens, but it shows something else too. Given that it was written and delivered in June 2015, it shows uncanny insight, even foresight, on the direction the country was taking.
You know, anyone can make a name for themselves in this reality TV age, especially in today's politics. If you're loud enough or controversial enough, you can get some attention. But to make that name mean something, to have it associated with dignity and integrity, That is rare. There's no shortcut to get it. It's not something you can buy. But if you do right by your children, maybe you can pass it on. And what greater inheritance is there? What greater inheritance than to be part of a family that passes on the values of what it means to be a great parent? That passes on the values of what it means to be a true citizen. That passes on the values of what it means to give back fully and freely without expecting anything in return. That's what our country was built on. Men like Bo. That's who built it. Families like this.
And then we had this. At the end of the eulogy, Barack closed his folder and walked off the altar. Shortly before Barack and Joe were to leave the White House for good, the president wanted to let his vice president know how much he valued him, respected him, and without getting too sappy about it, loved him. And he found just the way to do it. 8 days before the new president moved into the White House, Barack conferred the Medal of Freedom, the nation's highest civilian honor, on the vice president. In doing so, Barack not only showed his personal gratitude for Joe's contribution to his presidency, but also bestowed an honor that acknowledged the vice president's long and exemplary service to the nation. Perhaps more important than that, the Medal of Freedom ceremony gave Barack one last time as president to publicly profess his love for Joe. He drew on William Butler Yeats to put his feelings into words, telling the room, "Think where man's glory most begins and ends, and say my glory was, I had such friends." We won't go further into the Medal of Freedom ceremony here. The book has a detailed chapter on it, revealing the elaborate lengths Obama's and Biden's aides went to keep it a secret from Joe. Obama demanded it. He wanted to surprise his buddy, and he got the anticipated response. It was a powerful, tear-jerking moment for Joe. At the end of the Medal of Freedom ceremony, Joe told a favorite story of his. The moment he recounts took place during the first year of Barack and Joe's time in the White House. Now here, just days before the inauguration of the next president, Joe was absorbed by the unexpected joy he and Barack had created for themselves and for the nation.
About 6 months in, the president looked at me and said, "You know, Joe, you know what surprised me? We've become such good friends." And I said, "Surprised you?"
So Obama and Biden surmounted the odds. The institution of the presidency worked against them. Their distinctly different characters worked against them. The politics of men in high places worked against them. But still, they became friends. I believe they adored each other and still do. But now Joe is seeking his lifelong dream of the Oval Office, and Barack is seeking to secure the legacy of his presidency. This has caused some tensions in the relationship. Does Barack support his buddy's bid for the White House? Is Joe leaning too much on his Obama years to bolster his campaign? Will they ever be as close again as they were in the past? All we know is their White House years are behind them, and Barack and Joe are setting off into the next phase of their profound and complicated friendship. Thank you. I guess we can do questions if anybody has any or would like to ask anything, pose anything, complain about anything. No complaints? Really? Go to the mic.
Thank you for that, Steve. It's part of the poignancy of the story, which you tell brilliantly, is looking back on those days and taking into account what we now experience. But in real time, there was tension. And I don't remember feeling relaxed ever about the relationship or about Barack Obama and Joe Biden's place in the top of leadership in America. You've learned a lot about Joe Biden. Does he have it? Can he do it? Would we be wise to support him?
Oh, that's a tough question. And I'm not a political pundit. And I'm, you know, I'm not a Biden partisan by any stretch. But what he does bring, as we all know, and as this talk, I think, conveyed, is that he's a decent man. He's a truly decent man. And it's a rare thing for a politician, I think, to have those qualities, and especially in contrast to what we're seeing now. Beyond that, though, I do think because he wanted to be the vice president he wanted to be, he was very close to the operations and the administration and the thinking of Barack Obama. He had 8 years of on-the-job training, really, for the presidency, and he was in that room all the time, sort of learning from a very smart guy who knew what he was doing most of the time, tried to do his best. So I think, you know, in terms of the candidates who are out there, yes, Biden probably has the most experience and is most ready to move into the Oval Office immediately. But as we all know, and as we've all watched as the news progresses, there are so many more issues that people are looking at. And so my answer is, I don't know.
Hi, thank you for your talk. My question is, you know, are there examples of policies where Biden weighed in that we know of where he influenced decisions that were made?
Oh, that's a good question, too. I think he liked to not let people know, I think, where he was influencing. I mean, his influence was really behind the scenes. His influence was in those policy meetings where people were talking. And his role really was to get conversation from all the other people in the room going. He played the devil's advocate and sort of like saying things that people in the room may not want to say in front of the president because they were afraid of tipping their hat in the way that they felt, so that the whole room sort of kind of bubbled with ideas because Joe was trying to make it happen. And I think as Obama said in the very beginning here in 60 Minutes, that he needed that sort of thing because, I mean, he knew he was a young guy and he was a new guy, and he really was very good at synthesizing ideas. And if he had the full breadth of people talking and thinking for him, he could go away and make the decision. Joe could contribute to that. But he was also so loyal, I think, that he just didn't let on where he, you know, contributed concretely to the way that a policy decision might have happened. We saw a little bit at one point that, and I think this is true. I don't know. I never saw for a fact that it was, that he was sort of he was opposed to the bin Laden raid to take out Osama bin Laden because he thought it was very risky and it could sort of just kill Obama's administration if it failed. Well, if that were true, then that was one time he was certainly wrong. That's it.
I actually have another question. So you said, you know, that there's some inherent tension in the relationship between vice presidents and presidents, but you did point out Mondale and Carter, and it seemed like maybe they were friends. I mean, are there, as you look back, at least in the more recent history, are there other examples where there was at least a, construct a partnership? And I keep thinking about Cheney and Bush and being especially interested in your ideas around that.
Yeah. I don't think there were, constructive partnership. I think that Cheney Bush partnership might be described the opposite way. They certainly weren't chums and they weren't friends. And we all know how Cheney, was running his own shadow government in a way. Our current president and vice president don't seem to be terribly chummy together. I think, Mondale and Carter came the closest, and Carter would like to call Mondale his friend, but I don't get the sense, and there was never really much reporting on their truly being, hanging out buddies and having a good time the way these two guys did. And so I do think that, in a sense, Obama and Biden were truly historic for the way that they just melded together, got over their differences. They were such different people. And it was broader than just them. It was their families. The wives worked together for military families. The kids and grandkids got together for overnight, sleepovers, and went to, out in the town stuff together. So it was something more holistic in a way, and very much based on family.
Hi, Steve. You just sort of touched on my question. It also seemed, at least on the surface, that the First Lady and Jill Biden had a very similar relationship. I know it's not the point of your work, but in doing your research, did you come across that, or was their friendship as deep and meaningful?
I think they had a fine relationship, but I think from what my research told me that Joe sort of relied on Michelle to try to figure out Barack. He would go to her and they would talk about, from my understanding, they would talk about Obama, Barack Obama, and how he felt about things, why he felt the way he did about things. And of course, she had great insight to provide him with. And I do think, again, with the families being so close, that there was obviously a closeness between Joe and Michelle, and Jill Biden and Michelle and the whole group. But that's sort of what cemented it. Okie doke. Thanks.